Okay, I want to try to address this additional issue that's come up. Two people have written to me to query a little bit more about why I suggested that a high form of Christianity was the ideal matrix, or indeed just pointing to the fact that it was the matrix that Bataille seems to have chosen in order to further his very non-religious and atheistic ideas. So I had the query on the one side, which is, would any sort of Christianity do? And what is it? I think, what is it about the content of Christianity that might make it function as such an ideal matrix? And then I had the other question on the other side, which is like, the other question was about can't we just consider that everybody has individual lives and that it can be described, their lives can be described through a different kind of matrix, like the Heideggerian matrix, and it doesn't actually need Bataille's approach, perhaps, or it doesn't need this Christian matrix to, according to this commenter, describe people's lives. And so, therefore, why did I say what I did? I hope I've given a rough approximation to your questions. But let me at least try to get a little bit more deeply into it, into why I made the general analysis that I did, and what the further aspects of it would be if you were to fill in more detail. Let me try to do that. And it would be helpful if you would allow me to refer to my own experiences and to myself, because that is a really helpful thing to do, having been myself exposed to one of the more, perhaps the most contemporary extreme form of Christianity, where life and death were at stake. I think it's very, very helpful for me to be able to refer to that sense of things historically, that sense of things in Rhodesia, and to try to give an indication of how a very formal sense of Christianity could be very useful to drive the project ahead. Please also have a look at my video that's now uploading. Concerning Geist, the Hegelian concept of spirit. It's the one that will hopefully upload just before this one. So, let me answer the second question a little bit first, and say, well, it's not about describing a situation, not about creating a matrix that can overlay and account for individual experiences and individual relations. It's not about that. It's about creating a system that can create tension in your mind. It's about creating kind of a jungle gym to play on, but a very large jungle gym. Do you know a jungle gym, like when we were kids, we had bars going this way and bars going that way, horizontal and vertical bars, and you could swing on them, you could climb up in different manners and different angles. So the matrix I'm talking about is not a descriptive matrix. It's a constructive matrix. It's a matrix that enables you to do things rather than a matrix that enables you to understand things. Maybe you might not understand things too well if you're swinging by one of the higher bars by your legs and you lose orientation. You might have a very quaint and interesting experience, or maybe a threatening and shocking or dangerous experience, and you can't exactly describe it, but you can at least have that experience, and you can at least react to that experience, and that's the difference right there. So it's not a descriptive matrix. It's a, for want of a better word, it's a constructive matrix. It's a matrix that allows experience to take place with the different gradations of it, depending on where the horizontal bars are fixed. So that's why that's just one of the big differences I see in this type of philosophy of Nietzsche and Bataille, that the orientation is not exactly theoretical or contemplative so much as interactive and experiential and experimental as well. I hope that sort of somewhat addressed the second issue of how Bataille's paradigm differs from the Heideggerian contemplative one. One would not wish to sit there in the pasture and enjoy the environment and have a happy mood or have a different kind of a mood and acknowledge one's own experience. One would actually like to challenge the highest bar on the jungle gym and see whether by leaping for it or by dangling from one's legs, whether one can hold on or whether one falls off. It's experimental. With regard to the first question, let me catch my breath. Why this kind of Christianity? Well, this is where I do need to call upon my own experience, because it does seem very, very relevant. When Rhodesia was in place, the constitution of unilateral declaration of independence, based on that unilateral declaration, was announced. I'm diving in at the deep end. This is hard to explain. Let me leap out of the deep end again. Let me go to slightly more shallow waters. The historical situation was such that it had been a self-governing colony since, I believe, 1923, and Rhodesia saw that other colonies like itself, which had more direct governance, were being given over to majority black rule. And since there were many whites in that country, they thought, well, why not just be our own self-governing, why not be our own nation and declare independence and not have to hand over our power to another ethnic group just because it seems politically correct to do so. So they rebelled against that, and they rebelled on the basis that they were Christians that had something very valuable in terms of Christianity and the sense of that being the core of Western civilization, to maintain in their part of the world. So it was a rebellion based on a sense, in some respects, of religious precepts and notions about what Western civilization was, and very, very much in terms of this idea about Christianity being at the core of what Western civilization ought to be. So, in 1965, 11th of November, the unilateral declaration of independence was announced from Britain, and then the war was on because Britain didn't like that and nobody liked it. The black nationalists who wanted power didn't like that. The rest of the world didn't like that because they thought it was racist, and the fight was on. And there was my point being at this stage, there was something tremendous at stake, ideas about what Western civilization was one idea, was one thing at stake. The other hidden factor that was much more in my mind important that became at stake was people's lives, because there was from then on a civil war. And many people, in a very noble gesture, went to war on behalf of Western civilization and Christianity, my family members included, and died on behalf of that ideal. My uncle died. My other uncle stepped on a landmine that had been set by our side, and his leg got kind of blown up somewhat, but he made it. But my other uncle bled out and died, and that was a terrible tragedy. Looking back, one has very, 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 very mixed feelings. It's a great sense of ambivalence, because it was very noble. It was about as noble as anything that any human being can experience in their lifetime, to see people sacrifice themselves for their ideal and to believe in an ideal so much that they will do that. On the other hand, it seems, in relation to the modern perspective on things, it seems folly, and one feels desperately sad. Nonetheless, this is what I'm getting at when I speak about the matrix that one can have within one's psyche, the sense of the Christian matrix. It forces one, if one has such a matrix and has internalized such a matrix, it forces one to face things in a way that one would not otherwise do. It can raise one's level of courage to the top, to the highest level that one can have it raised to. It also binds one to a sense of a value, in the sense that, well, others have sacrificed themselves. What does it mean to me? And then in relation to that huge value that was put in place when my uncle sacrificed himself, what do I do? How do I recognize that? How do I acknowledge it? How do I come to terms with that? So it puts you in that very uncomfortable position of trying to reckon with it, which is a position where you really are grappling with spirit. You're grappling with the utmost difficulty that the human mind can encounter. And lastly, it makes you consider things in terms of truth. What was true about that? What wasn't true about that? You can become very, very, if you have an internal matrix in your psyche, you can become very perplexed, but very overwrought and very driven to be more discerning and refined about questions of truth. So I would not want to disrespect my uncle. How do I handle my knowledge of history in relation to this question of truth? And I have to do it with reverence. Otherwise, I'm in a mode of disrespect in relation to important things. So I'm bound to truth. I'm bound to rigor. I'm bound to grappling with my own ambivalence. And I think in all of these ways, this is the sense in which an extreme or formal Christianity can have a positive benefit in terms of keeping us on track, on the path of Geist or spirit, and really, in my case, not easily able to get off of it. I hope that makes a little bit of sense.